Thanks so much, Richard. One piece of feedback I got from Richard last night is that I should go slower, and so well, maybe it's too late now, but but I'll try.
So let me ask a general question.
Yes.
So you said that these generating series you're going to create are not the say curve counts on a particular variety. Because
that's right.
Change from variety.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
But is there some sense in which it's the either the average or
like a very generic, it's like
so set,
well, there may not be a big dense set, big, you know, suppose you do it in P3, right? There's no deformation of P3,
right.
Yet this virtual count will not be the actual count, just because the moduli, the curves, like, you know, like Hilbert scheme of P3, that's whatever, it's still too big a dimension to be an expected dimension, so it's still some virtual count. Like if you could deform, you can say, well, I'm looking for like holomorphic map, some solution, some D bar problem, or some such thing. Like if I could perturb that problem sufficiently generical, that would be the count. Yeah, but if you stay within algebraic geometry, I don't think you can. I mean, I don't know if you of a perturbation generic enough to give it an actual count.
But like in the Calabi-Yau threefolds.
Still. Yeah, it's better. It's like you know, we always count stuff with multiplicities and such, and it's always better to do that rather than to. I don't know. Besides, one is interested. The reason, the main interest, why people are interested in this, is because people want to know something about, like, infinite dimensional problem mathematical physics, and the index of some Dirac operator on infinite dimensional spaces is computed in this way. It's not the fact that it's sometimes enumerative, that's nice, but this is not the goal, so to speak. Right. All right. So so today we will focus on very particular threefold. There'll be some base curve B, and a vibration, so threefold I'll call Y, because there'll be more important, so I'd like to reserve X for more important things, and there'll be more important things later in the lecture. And besides, it's going to look a little bit like Y, so this will be, so in general, this could be a total space of AN surface vibration, but we will just take this AM surface to be A0 surface, just C2. So it's just a total space of, and in fact, I'll take it the total space of two, direct sum of two line bundles. I'll call them L1 and L2. And one wants to count curves in this geometry. So we look at this. So this is my Y. And I want to look at the PT space of Y. This is the space of parametrized pairs. So you have a coherent sheaf with a surjection from a map with the structure sheaf, and there's this co-kernel zero, where this is pure one-dimensional, and this is zero-dimensional, and the kind of element in the space would like to show graduate students before they sign the lives away is the following. So imagine one or both of these bundles are positive, and pick some nice multi-section, something, I don't know, something like this. So something which maps, so there'll be mapping to the base with a certain degree here, 3, and pick a divisor on it. So divisor D, so my curve C, and divisor D, and so this a particular element here could be, but this is O of D, and this is the natural map, natural section. This is OC of D. Of course, there's many more things in the space, but this is. Like I said, this is the model house they show to the customers. So, and then the question would be to do this counts And it's very important in this context. Geometry is obviously completely non-compact. It's very important to keep track on this geometry. I have an action. So if I pick the sum of two line bundles, I have an action of a two-dimensional torus. Maybe I'll write it like this. So in general, if I have a vibration of this A and singularities, or A and surfaces rather, then it'll be similarly an action of two-dimensional torus. And if I remember the action of this torus, then while my geometry is completely very non-compact, and so the Euler characteristic, if I compute the Euler characteristic without the group action, there'll be just infinite dimensional spaces. But with the group action, the weight multiplicity will be finite dimensional. So this will make sense. Yeah? Is that clear? What were them?
The functor of those systems.
Oh yeah, there's a very nice moduli space for this. This is I picked in, this is a very nice moduli space, and you just as with this on that moduli space there's a sheaf for virtual, and we take, and the kind of thing we want to take is like yesterday. This is summation over all possible. So maybe we fix that here's the degree, is the degree with which this curve maps here. So maybe in this picture degree is 3, and this we fix. But we sum over all possible Euler characteristic of F, so we sum over.
Is the support of F finite over B?
Say it again?
Is F finite over B?
It is a, so you're right. I didn't say it is proper. It supports proper, yeah. So in particular, yeah. So the kind of thing we want to compute is like minus z to the maybe the Euler. So the Euler that we want to compute over the Euler characteristic over that moduli space of that sheaf, and that, as we discussed, this includes a prefactor. Which is minus z to the Euler characteristic of f, and so if once we fix degree, then this will be a generating function over possible Euler characteristics, or this is. It's like. Yeah. It's not right. I mean, in general, in any threefold problem, z is just bookkeeping. And then if you think of in terms of fivefold, then it becomes an actual thing that acts. And this is especially nice in this geometry, because you think, what's going to be fivefold? Fivefold, we get two more bundles, two more land bundles, and they'll play completely symmetric role. But we're not going to talk about this today. And so how we got there? We got here by trying to degenerate an arbitrary threefold into something like this. We can continue to play this game. We can take a curve. This b, we can also so degenerate. So it means we can have a situation where you have a b could be a node. Yeah. It's any such moduli space has this. This is the object we introduced. This is first you look at this virtual structure sheaf, and then you tensor with some improved square root of the virtual canonical. This is how the curve counts are defined. And you take the you have a specific, you know, specific very particularly interesting sheaf, and you take its other characteristic. And you take this other characteristic, you take equivariant. So this will be sitting in this will be an infinite series in variables t1 and t2, where each coefficient will record the weight of the the multiplicity of the corresponding weight space in that other characteristic. So going back to the idea that we can the curve itself b, we can of course also degenerate, and so what's it going to be? Then this means in my threefold I'll have a divisor, which is the fiber over this green point. Maybe I'll draw it green. Maybe it's too bright a green, but. And then I didn't say how you glue curves in. So this is now the situation when I have two y's that degenerated in the union of y1 and y2 along a divisor D. And I didn't explain how to glue curves, but it's intuitively clear that we'll have something with the following idea, that you have to have a curve in one side and a curve in another side. And they'll have to exactly match over that divisor. So it means their intersection. So from either side, I get a point. This intersection is really a point in the Hilbert scheme of these D points, and the two things will have to exactly match. In general, so that has to be kept. So the point of that is that, of course, intersection with fiber is only a rational map on this moduli space, and to have a reasonable intersection with the divisor, you have to have a resolution of this map. I'm not going to explain how this is done. There's a different moduli space called moduli space of relative. Stable pairs or relative PT moduli space, or it's also there's any of this moduli of sheaves Hilbert scheme and so on. There's a notion of relative such moduli space relative to a divisor, which resolves the rational map taking the intersection of your curve at the divisor. It's a beautiful geometric construction the way it's constructed. This will not fit into three lectures if I start going about it. But you should think that in reality there's something happening over this point. It's not what you see is what you get. There's much more to this picture which I'm not explaining. But in the end of the day, you have this evaluation map, and you have to pull back the diagonal from the Hilbert scheme of point via this pair of this evaluation maps. That makes sense? So in particular, of course, that means that any curve B whatsoever, and I'll draw a slightly contradictory picture. So if I had a curve B, this, of course, I could degenerate to a union of three-pointed rational curves, so something like this, where all this, the green points, where is my bright green? These are the green points, the points over which there's some gluing in the fibers. And the reason I introduced this extra component here is because this is in this process, I also get to decide what to do with these line bundles. And I can assign the degrees any way we like. And so in particular, I can move all the degree. I can assume that L1 and L2 are non-trivial only on this piece, and everywhere else they're trivial. For example, so I can break things in very simple pieces, namely a piece with non-trivial line bundles, and a piece with a rational curve with three marked points, and trivial line bundles L1 L2. That everybody's with me. So in other words, the big problem of how to degenerate threefolds at this level reduced to just familiar two-dimensional. When people talk about degenerating such objects, the language for this is two-dimensional topological 2D TQFT, and how you glue things out of. So it's really like 2D TQFT, slightly enhanced. Plus, you have to keep track of these degrees. When you break in pieces, you have to keep track of where were the degrees. Let's just write the degrees of these bundles, because that's everything's deformation invariant. The only thing which makes sense is just the degree. So on every component, you have to remember this thing. And so everything you can obtain by gluing very basic pieces, and so in particular one such piece is that I can pick. I can pick.
So your log component with less than three interesting matters.
Say again?
Your log component.
Yeah, of course you can. You can do anything you want. You can have four. I'm just saying if you want. But if yeah, but all I'm saying you can if you want to get you want to get rid of these bundles, or you can just move them to one separate component and worry about it later. And so the building blocks in your theory becomes the following things. Maybe I'll, so you have say with the number of marked points, could be any number of marked points. And then you have this, so you have that curve. Yeah, I'll have. I will regret my choice of colors because I will have to erase this at some point, and that'll be hard thing to do. It'll stay with us forever. And so instead of then your basic building block becomes. So say you have k relative points. Then you have evaluation map that goes from pt. Or y relative to this point in the base, maybe b1 up to bk. And like I said, I didn't explain what's in that moduli space, but it is some moduli space resolved evaluation map. Then to resolve the rational evaluation map from this moduli space. This is going to go to just to the Hilbert scheme. Well, to name a spade, this divisor is just nothing but c2. And it has d points in it. And this will be go to the power k. Right? And so if we push forward, what we, if we want to glue, if we're going to glue these counts out of pieces, well, what we do is we push forward this overhead. And this will be an element in a k-fold tensor product of some space H, where H is the current K theory with respect to this. So this is my torus T of X, where X is the Hilbert scheme of the divisor. So finally that clear? Everybody's on board? And so I get what the language for describing will just some TQFT slightly with slight enhancement by this thing, by this data, and this space. And this, how big is this space? It's roughly the same as representations of symmetric group of SD. It's index, its rank is the number of partitions of the number d.
What's x?
X is the Hilbert scheme. So x. So why is less important object than x, and x is this? All right. And so. And so similarly, of course, for AM vibrations, we do M equals zero, but you can do the same for AM vibrations, and you get your X becomes this Hilbert scheme of dead point points. And H becomes the K theory of that. So now, this is a very famous space in geometric representation theory. I'll just write GRT. fact, this guy, this Hilbert schemes of IM surfaces, they belong to a very large class of nice algebraic varieties called Nakajima varieties. Which more or less specifically invented so to geometrically realize actions of interesting Lie algebra, or interesting quantum group. So in conventional representation theory, so this is like a very this is so to speak in the middle. The what I mean by this is, so the conventional representation theory concerns with representing objects by matrices acting on vector spaces. You can view, maybe very superficially, a vector space as K theory of a finite set, finitely many points, the simplest algebraic variety. And then a matrix is a K class on the product. And these things, and the K classes, if you have classes, K classes on the product, they multiply just the same as matrices multiply, and they act on the K theory of your original variety, which is the same as matrices act on vector spaces.
Is this what you teach in linear algebra?
Exactly, yeah. There's always, yeah. or rather, this is what the students tell you those days if you ask them to find eigenvalues. So, integral is a functor, so I don't compute them. Yeah, so, is that clear? So, this is, so everybody's on board with that? And so, specifically, so. Yeah.
Of course, the students believe it, but you know.
I think if your vector space is canonical, a K-theory of a finite set, then you're in good shape. And I think it has a basis. In fact, let's not get into this discussion. We all have our linear algebra stories to tell. So what I was going to say, this is associated, Nakajima variety is associated to an arbitrary, so this guy is associated to an arbitrary quiver, and quiver is a beautiful word, but it means nothing but a bunch of points and segments joining them. So there's no, in fact, for Nakajima variety, the orientation is not important, so you can have like three things going here, two loops, something like that. And these particular ones, these occur for cyclic quivers. You get these ones. And so then the K theory, so maybe Nakajima variety X. And if I look at the equivariant K theory of that number variety X, that's naturally a module over, well, this is some complicated algebra, which it's best not to think about it too much right now. We will those of you who want to worry about it can come to the lecture tomorrow and we'll deal with it. So this will be about the way this algebra is defined. This is the plan. This will postpone it. We'll kick that can down the road. We'll define it later. There are some complicated. It's quantized h-bar means deformation of the universal enveloping of the loop algebra of some Lie algebra, G, where G is more or less, so G, where G is something, it's some algebra, it's a little bit hard to define what it is, but it contains, it's something generally bigger than, associated to any quiver like this, you can write, sort of Cartan matrix, which would be on the diagonal will have 2 minus the number of loops, so it'll be 2 minus 2, 2, and off diagonal will be the number of edges, something like this. Associated to this algebra, you can associate either Katz-Moody or Borchardt-Katz-Moody algebra, so let's say Katz-Moody Lie algebra. In general, this will be in general much, much bigger. And so Nakajima constructs the action of this guy. This is Nakajima. This in this there's some product of JLs and SPs that acts on this. So every time you have a loop, you get some SP, and every time you have there's some product of JLs for each vertex, and there's like here, there's you get one. There's one C star for here. You get, well, anyway, there's some way to write down. It's a product of very simple things that acts on this. So to be very specific, this is the X is not some very it's not a very mysterious thing. It's the algebraic symplectic reduction of some particular representation of a product of general linear groups. And where this representation is a direct sum of defining representation, homes between them, and endomorphism of them. And that's the defining representation you just ignore, and the home and endomorphisms you record in terms of the arrows. And then of course the centralizer, this is algebraic symplectic reduction. So this is, and then centralizer of this action in this representation will then act on the corresponding equation. And the contribution, the construction of this thing, this is in my book with Davesh Molek, this I'll try to explain. Constructed differences, not constructed. Katz-Moody is constructed, it's always constructed by generators in relations. This is the general spirit to construct Katz-Moody Lie algebras. And these guys are generally infinitely generated, even this Lie algebras. And so it's not, you construct them differently. You don't construct them by generators in relations. Anyway, we'll worry about this later. But in this particular instance, there's not here. So maybe I'll write four. We shouldn't be worried too much about this. And for this x, the corresponding algebra U H bar is a certain deformation of loops into G L M plus one. So the algebra G loops into GLM. It's not exactly Katz-Moody because of this G, because of the central thing. And this is, you think it's very minor, but the old geometry sits in that central thing. I mean, all geometrically interesting information is there. And so in particular here, what we lacked is UH bar of GL1 hat. And what this thing is, I'll explain tomorrow. And everything will be in terms of this. This whole data of this TQFT will be in terms of this, but will be in terms of the specific thing we want is something like a wild group of this object. So the specific thing we're interested in will be like a wild group of this. And why we're interested in this? We're interested in this because while all these counts we do here, they all, well, somebody should have pointed out, this of course depends on this is a summation over all z. So this is not really in this space, but in power series in z. And these guys are, as before, these are rational functions. Of course, there's nothing simpler and nothing harder than a rational function, because rational function is, you know, it's like an elementary object in mathematics. It's very hard to break it into further pieces. But if we consider, if B has only two marked points, then there's bigger group of automorphism. And if we bring that into the picture, we can break we can break these rational functions further into pieces that will be determined by a certain interesting difference equation. So the where we're going is I'm going to explain that there is a certain very interesting difference equation in this business, and in general, for any general Nakajima variety, there is a certain very interesting Q difference equation. And that Q difference equation has to do with the whatever the Weyl group of that object is. So how does it go? So this picture is almost okay, except I need to make this thing straight so that it looks like P1. So. So if my base curve B is P1 with two marked points, we call them 0 and infinity if you want, then of course there's automorphism, which I denote Q. Q is an element in C star, a multiplicative group of a field if you want. But I did, from the very beginning, I thought of my field by complex numbers, which I'll denote Q because it has an element Q. And so then, with these two non-trivial line bundles, we can compute. So this will be our, I have two relative. I can take two relative points. So where's my chemical? This is my very chemical chalk. I can take two relative points. And I have an element. And so this gives me, this gives me an element, evaluation of this to my point, gives me an element in H square, which in fact I claim is a convolution of, in the obvious sense, which you can, of two, it's like, this is like this is a kind of endomorphisms of the space. The space has a bilinear form, so you can just think of. So this is a convolution. If I keep equivalence with respect to this guy, it's a convolution of two more basic things. Namely, in equivalent K theory, we have localization theorem. Localization theorem says that all computations are determined by infinitesimal neighborhood of the fixed locus. Locus fixed under the action of well, you can also do the action of T1 and T2, but let's do T1 and T2 both. And that Q.
How things mix, because
what? Oh yeah, so of course you can. Yeah, so you can think. So if this is acted by weights T1 and T2, and if maybe my Li, it doesn't really matter. So you can take Li to be O of Ki times 0. So I'll renderize it like this, and so then the weights here will be Q to the power K1 T1. And similarly, the shift, right? That does answer your question? Everybody's on board with this computation? So now what's a fixed locus going to look like? How can an element in this moduli space be ever fixed by rescaling the virus scale in Q? The only possibility is this is, well, first of all, I'm taking the whole fixed locus, so it has to be that you have some thickening of just this zero section. My whole curve is just big fat thickening of the zero section. But moreover, that thickening has no, so maybe I'll write that thickening as a handlebar. Or sorry, what's the word? What do they lift? What did they always used to lift in this? What? Dumbbell, yeah. And that dumbbell has no features whatsoever in the middle, right? Because there's no way for it to be fixed unless it's just constant here. It is, I mean, not so complicated, it's just a fixed point. The fixed points on the Hilbert schema are indexed by those positions, exactly right. There's some precision in the middle that runs along this. Along this thing will run some precision. These are the fixed points of my torus on the Hilbert scheme, monomial ideal. And so but the point is that this object has no features it's constant in the middle, right? So it's visibly my fixed locus. So if I look at PT, at this particular PT moduli space, if I look at the fixed locus of my torus cross that C star Q, that's just a fiber product of over simple things. So I can take PT of Y, so to speak, you know, kind of relative this point and just non-singular the other point, and the other way around. Is that everybody with me on board? So I take relative zero and non-singular at some other point, which I might as well denote infinity here, over Hilb C2 fixed points with. So again, still fixed points, T, C, Q. Just doing fixed points right now. And the other way around, relative infinity and non-singular at zero. So it's like you can take this dumbbell, and if it's a very bad idea athletically, just to put all the weight on one side or the other side, but from this point of view, it's like a dumbbell. It has, I mean, this weight only talks to this weight only through the whatever runs through the hood. And so then you see that this is, of course, then whatever you compute on this moduli space is going to be, in fact, a convolution of two simpler things. Right? Well, simpler. Not really, because so what you prove, basic theorem in the subject, is that if you compute the corresponding, so I'll just, you know, I'm not going to copy the definition again. It's going to be, you know, this will give you, this object will give you some element in H square of series Z. And what this thing is, this is a fundamental solution. Of a certain Q difference, regular Q difference with regular singularity means Q difference equation, regular singularity, Q difference equation with regular singularities. And then this whole thing, the convolution of the two, it's now a rational function with what it is. It's a shift operator. So this fundamental with regular singularities and parameters, so then it has parameters T1, T2. And this big thing, it is now a rational function, but this thing is shift operator for this equation, which sends Ti to Q. So the analogy, you think, so super for ridiculous analogy, you can think of hypergeometric equations, Q hypergeometric equation, Q hypergeometric function. Maybe we'll write it phi, and then plus 1 has some variables, maybe call it b0. Bn and then a0 an, where this thing has to be q, and then some variable z So this satisfies a Q difference equation in this variable. But there are commuting Q difference equations in all these variables. That's something that conjugates the equations for Z into equations with shifted parameters under these things. Those are rational in variables that they're rational. And these are what are the things called in the classical theory of hypergeometric functions? Contiguity something or other, or
contiguity means the exponents shift.
Yeah, that's what it means, right? So if these are the exponents, if you shift them by Q, that's the analog of, in the Q difference world, that's the analog of shifting them by an integer.
Nice, contiguity.
Yeah, contiguity. Okay. And so this is exact analog of this, except of course this would be slightly misleading to compare it with a hypergeometric equation, because I've so now of course you'll be laughing that I asked for 40 copies of this formula, and of course I grossly overestimated the number of people. So what this equation looks like for d equals 3, this would be, this equation would be some equation, three-dimensional space. We have three, there are three partitions of the number 3. So KC has rank 3, and with some equation. And that's, so I printed out what it is. It's a matrix of that equation. It's the product of the matrices that are given on this page. So maybe you can just, then I'll look at it for a second. And it's so. Anyway, so the point of that is not to scare you. The point of that, or maybe it is, it's like public key crypto system. It's without knowing how I wrote down these matrices. I don't know how you can actually go about reconstruct this equation. Certainly, for example, it's not, hypergeometric equation is rigid. This is equation certainly not rigid in any sense of the word. It's a very special equation. It's a question be how we're going to write that equation. And so, and the answer to that is that this is a product of five things for a good reason. And the reason is that, so the way to write this equation is the following. That to any right.
Is that right? And that it's satisfying some
first order. Yeah. First order. It's a fundamental solution of a certain first order Q difference 3x3 equation. Sorry. Did I just erase what you was?
So what are these matrices here?
These are 3x3 matrices. You have to multiply them to get the matrix of the equation. H bar, right. Yeah, H bar is. So let me actually look at that. So is there H? Where do you see H bar? So H bar is a. So it's the first shift. It's right. That's right. So h bar is just abbreviation of 1 over t1 t2. It's the weight of the symplectic form. So it's just there are shifts by this everywhere, and this is stuff. So you just ignore that. So the reason is that to every. So to every x, which is so. Maybe. Maybe I'll put here. Nakajima varieties, they in turn belong to a bigger set of varieties, which are called equivariant symplectic resolutions. And the theorem, which with some luck I'll state today, is for Nakajima varieties because they're special. Inside of all equivariant symplectic resolutions, but the beginning discussions I'm going to give now applies to arbitrary x in this world. So if you have x, then in fact, so there's so there's the following slogan, which is you should take with a grain of salt. So that says that equivariant symplectic resolutions are the Lie algebras of the 21st century. Okay, well, don't take it too seriously. But if you believe in anything like this, there should be a notion of what are the roots and what are the coroots. So the coroots will sit, and the way you should think about it, so if I have my original Lie algebra G, which is the Lie algebra of the 19th century, then it corresponds to equivariant symplectic resolution, which is T star of G mod B. This is a resolution, this is a symplectic variety, which by the moment map resolves the nilpotent cone in G star. Classical coroots are particular curves in this G mod B, or particular curves in here. You should think of this as X. Classically, coroots are curves in G mod B, and so curves in here, curve classes. And so there are two pictures one can associate. So first, you can look about for coroots. So coroots, be some coroots, be some subset in H2XZ. And so this will, in particular, cut out hyperplanes in H upper 2X. I don't know, take with any coefficients, let's say with real coefficients, which is also pick X tensor R. So first you can look at a central arrangement. So it means these are the elements of so maybe coroots alpha. First we're gonna look at just things where these guys vanish. This will determine them, of course, up to proportionality. And so these things that vanish here, this space here, this is the space.
What's the curve associated to
coroot
alpha?
So if I have a coroot, I have a map from SL2 to G, and that induces a P1 on G mod B. And so P1 in here. So this, among other things, this space is the deformations, you mentioned deformation space. transformation space of the pair x omega, because this deformation space is just classified by the period map, by the class of omega inside H upper 2. Just this is what parametrizes this deformation. And this is nothing but the discriminant. So this is the discriminant. This set is the discriminant. This is the set of all deformations for this, for those, for x mapping to its affinization to the spec of global functions. Is not an isomorphism. So this is not an isomorphism precisely away from this hyperplane. So this in this G mod B situation, the deformations are just the deformation is just a general. This deforms to a general co-adjoint orbit. And that is a fine unless you have two eigenvalues coincide. Have I lost you guys? Or so if I'm working for deformation of this space, what's the deformation? It's a you can think of it as a twisted cotangential bond G mod B, but what it is a general coadjoint orbit. And this is affine outside of the discriminant set. And the discriminant set, what is the component of the discriminant set? It's just this: if I have a component in alpha perp or alpha pair lambda is zero, that just means, or alpha pair omega is zero, better. Then just means that this collapses precisely, this contracts precisely that class, contracts precisely.
You're saying that H2X R is identified.
No. So this is the set of all deformations for which this map is not an isomorphism. The discriminant is here. In the deformations of this my space, I can ask for things which are not affine or a union somehow. And that would be over a union of finitely many hyperplanes that are called the coroutes. And then corresponding to this, so this determines this guy's up to multiplication. I mean, up to scale. And to fix that scale, we can introduce a corresponding affine arrangement. So it means I apologize, this is gonna be super, is it okay if I superimpose the affine arrangement over the So a fine arrangement would be where alpha dot omega, this is an integer. And so if you're in the classical situation, you're gonna get one of those pictures which we all know and love. It'll look something like this. But in general, it could be that both alpha and 2 alpha or 3 alpha are roots. It's very easy. Think of and I still have it. GL1 hat. What are the roots of? I don't have GL1 hat. We think what are the roots of GL1 hat? Well, the only sensible answer is all integers. Because GL1, right? And so in fact, so all integer multiple over roots are still roots. And so in this case, in addition to this picture we know and love, there'll be things which are like a parallel. So if suppose I have something which is 2 alpha, then means I have something which goes parallel here. So it's gonna look like this. Okay. So I'm gonna get a picture. So this will be, so this is, so. Sorry, I didn't tell you what the picture is. there will be some affine picture, which by this fixes for me the set of corus now with the length. So I haven't told you what the, I'll tell you what the picture is, and then it'll fix this. And so, but maybe before I'll tell you with the picture, I'll tell you the main takeaway from this picture. Is that this is a locally finite, finite periodic arrangement of rational hyperplanes. So far, just like a fine Weyl group. The main difference with the classical theory is that this is not going to be transitive. There's not going to be a transitive symmetry group. Is not going to act transitively, right? I mean, there is some symmetry group in this picture, but you see that this Alcove is fundamentally different from this Alcove. So there will be some affine group of symmetries, but it's not. So there's no reflections in general. No reflections unless you have a real root. And there's no, and therefore no transitivity. There's some group that acts with finitely many orbits, but it's not transitive.
On what would it be transitive in the
I mean, the Weyl group, the affine Weyl group acts transitively on the set of Alcoves.
On
Alcoves, yeah. Right, sorry, I didn't say no. So no reflections, no transitivity on Alcoves. The alcoves are connected components usually, as before. And so once this is, so I still owe you the definition of this thing, right? But the main definition becomes, and so instead of Weyl group, so what we had is a Weyl group. Of course, you can, or maybe affine instead of affine Weyl group. Lost my thought for a second. So, right, so this will be replaced, this would be, since we don't have reflections, but, so we will, this will be replaced by a version of Bray group, but in fact, so this right replacement of that is, you know, what some people call Deligne or fundamental groupoid of this arrangement. Everyone with me? So this will still, so maybe I'll copy this. This is in of complexification, of the complexification. So instead of, we won't have a reflection, but we'll have a notion of something, like if you start in some alcove, you can go over a hyperplane, go over another hyperplane, go over another hyperplane. Exactly. Right. And this will still, since the arrangement is periodic, that it does contain a lattice. This will contain this groupoid does contain a lattice, right? You can just go from alcove to here. So instead of here, there's a lattice. Which is just pick of X. And the action of in this lattice will act the way this difference operator is going to be written, it will be this action of this lattice. And the way it's going to be factored is it will be factored into things each individual going over. So what it is, so for the Hilbert scheme, for Hilbert scheme of C2 n, n points here, then you get peak, of course, is one dimensional. Peak x for x this, peak is z. So I have to draw a one-dimensional picture. And the roots are all integer up to roots are all integers up to n. Means where are the integers? So roots? They're all plus minus. It's fundamental fact. I mean, it's simple. It's easy. It's just generated by determinant of the tautological quotient sheaf. So we're maybe so roots are plus minus one up to plus minus n, and so then this means this root hyperplanes will go for all fractions of a over b where b is less or equal than n. Right, so this will be in addition. So you see, so your arrangement is going to look something like this. So it's all fractions with denominators at most n. You see, of course, it's there's a symmetry in the translation, but certainly not transitive on Alcove. And if you want a lattice generator, this will have to go over all these things. In particular, for the Hilbert scheme of 3 points. So I'll just draw a special picture for 3 points. So there's a half, there's 1/3. And so then you're gonna get. So this matrices that have fractions in them, they all correspond to these guys here. And now, well, I'm already 3 minutes over time. I still think. Sorry, so Richard, did you say? I mean, do ask what you want to ask. Yeah, so if somebody can ask me what is that hyperplane arrangement, this would count maybe like a question time because I'm already over time. So there are two answers to that. And they both in fact they originated here, more or less in this room. in back when Bessel-Kovnikov was whatever you call the distinguished professor. And so there are two things here. Is that one, this is the analog of the discriminant, but in this situation of these are bad values for quantization in characteristic P. So what Bessel-Kovnikov likes to do is take a symplectic manifold and quantize it in large positive, well, ideally in any prime characteristic, but particularly large positive prime characteristic. And this will have parameters just as, so quantizations will have just the same kind of parameters as, I mean, in addition to the strength of the non-commutativity, you also have all the parameters of deformation you had in the commutative situation. And so they'll have the same value of parameters, and you can ask the analog of, you can for say what the analog of this being not an isomorphism means, and there'll be certain bad values, and this will be exactly from this arrangement. I mean, this is familiar from conventional representation theory, because if you want to do it in characteristic, you want to study representation of Lie algebras in characteristic P, instead of looking at the central Weyl arrangement, you have to look at the affine Weyl arrangement with the difference between where the difference of hyperplanes is divisible, is 0 mod P. So, and the other answer, these are poles in some curve counting function, in some simpler, not the kind of not the things we're doing today, in some simpler curve counting functions. When you count curves, this is naturally you know, a curve concurs by, you know, by the degrees, you get a function on peak. And then this function will have poles, and these are the poles. In the complete generality, the equality of the two is a conjecture, back goes back to 208, but we've proven in a whole bunch of cases since then. But anyway, that's the definition of that arrangement. But for Nakajima variety, there's a simpler answer. For Nakajima variety, so there's a very simple answer. So for Nakajima variety, X is a K theory of X is really weight. It's a weight space. In a representation, and maybe weight space mu in a representation of my this algebra, and then you the roots of X, and I'll write this weight space nu as a difference between the lowest weight the lowest weight representation, so it's the lowest weight plus plus some correction, maybe I'll write it mu. And so then roots of X, this is now a positive linear combination of roots of my Lie algebra. So this is, then this roots of X are all roots of that Lie algebra G in the conventional sense, such that alpha is less or equal than mu. So in particular, here, if we go back here my G is GL1 hat. The roots of G are all integers, and the all integers without zero, if you want. And then that weight for the Hilbert scheme of n point, that number, that weight mu is n, and therefore you get roots up to n. So for Nakajima varieties, there's a lot less mystery about these things. And this follows, this is equivalent to this definition by a formula of Imolek and I. So, I apologize. It's getting longer and longer.